This Disney DVD is enhanced with Disney's FastPlay. Your movie and a selection of bonus features will begin automatically. To bypass FastPlay, select the main menu button at any time. FastPlay will begin in a moment. Pictures presents The Little Mermaid.
Oh my gosh.
For the first time ever on a two-disc special edition DVD.
Thank you. Sing with me now.
The adventure. The fun. The music. The classic story.
Is in love with a human.
Disney's The Little Mermaid.
Yes!
Winner of 2 Academy Awards.
That's right.
Someday I'll be part of your world.
For the first time ever on a two-disc special edition DVD. October 3rd.
What a soft shell I'm turning out to be.
Have you ever heard of a man turning into a dog?
Well, they all do eventually, don't they?
Shaggy, you're back!
This is a man who hates dogs.
Thanks, guys.
Good night, sir.
And through a strange circumstance...
Ow! You scared him!
Oh, he bit me!
He turns into a dog, and through being a dog, he learns to be a better human.
What's happening to me?
I keep my rhythm slow. I move my hand to the tempo.
I love you.
Did. We hooked up with these great actors. Jane Curtin's in this. Robert Downey Jr.
I am the chief scientist.
No more growling.
Silence, quiet.
I gotta go, guys.
Tim is funny all the time.
Don't talk to anybody. Don't play the music. You're in charge.
He can't help it.
I got you now. I'm not playing Frisbee.
I got it!
I am good.
Is there anyone who has not sniffed my butt?
What if you found out the sky was falling? Would you be scared? Maybe even a little... chicken?
Disney DVD.
A piece of the sky?
Not again! The sky is falling!
Something really big is going down.
What's that noise? Sorry. Nervous eater.
Walt Disney Pictures presents...
Come on, Dad. We've got a planet to save.
Rock me a little, hippie boy.
Chicken Little.
Look, Mama, there's the crazy chicken!
Yes, it is crazy, little chicken. You're so smart. We don't make eye contact. Bye-bye.
On March 21st. Some heroes are born great.
He's the greatest answer.
Others have greatness dropped upon them. Disney's Chicken Little.
Ready, little brother?
Let's do it, eh?
This is the night.
It's a beautiful night.
And they call it better. Day.
Day.
Hey, I'm Lady.
And I'm the Tramp. And welcome to our movie, eh?
Quiet, Moose Breath.
Hey, so before we start, we wanted to tell you about a new movie come to DVD.
Two bears.
Four moose.
One wild adventure.
Sounds big, eh?
Sure does, eh?
Brother Bear 2.
Hey, Big Brother, you think we fooled them?
Oh, yeah, definitely, eh?
They think it's Lady and the Tramp for sure.
And they call it Ben the Naughty.
Hey, who am I, Lady or the Tramp?
Figure it out, eh?
Okay.
Get ready for the biggest adventure five little pups ever had. So run, don't walk, for Disney's all-new adventure. From the doghouse to your house. Air Buddies, the all-new movie, coming soon to Disney DVD. This time, it's all in the family.
This is the night, it's a beautiful night, and we call it Mermaid. Look at the skies, they have stars in their eyes, on this lovely Mermaid. So take the love of your loved one, you'll need it about this time, to keep from falling like the star, when you make that dizzy climb. For this is the night, and the heavens are right, on this lovely Mermaid, on this lovely.
Walt Disney created one of the most beloved motion pictures of all time, Lady and the Tramp. And finally, releasing from the Disney vault, the story continues in Lady and the Tramp 2 Scamp's Adventure in a new special edition DVD.
This is everything
everything that I've ever dreamed of.
I still run, I still swing open the door. I still think you'll be there like before. Doesn't everybody out there know to never come round?
With bonus features including an all-new game and a new music video.
I'm still holding out.
It will capture your heart and spirit forever. Bring home the special edition of Lady and the Tramp 2, Scamp's Adventure. Coming to Disney DVD Fall 2006.
A story of loyalty, courage, and triumph. Celebrate Walt Disney's Dumbo in a new special edition coming 2006, only on Disney DVD.
So this is love. So this is love.
Hi, I'm Eric Goldberg. As you probably know by now, the process of developing a story for an animated film involves a lot of trial and error. Some ideas are tried and discarded fairly quickly. Others hang around for quite some time before they're finally dropped. One example of the latter for Lady and the Tramp was a sequence that was internally referred to as turning the tables. What would it be like if the roles were reversed and dogs kept humans as pets? A lot of early developmental art from the late 1930s exists that shows various ways of approaching this concept. The story development team must have thought this was a pretty good idea, because even as late as 1953, we find evidence that this sequence was still part of the movie. It was finally abandoned after an internal studio work-in-progress screening in May 1953, where the audience reaction to this scene was particularly adverse. But we have been lucky enough to find a full set of storyboards for the last attempt at making this concept work. Using the original artwork and dialogue from those storyboards, we've assembled a recreation of that scene for presentation on this DVD. It's a rare opportunity for us to see an extended sequence from Lady and the Tramp that didn't make it into the final film. Let's take a look.
Everybody knows a dog's best friend is a human.
Oh, come on now, fellas. Oh, you haven't fallen for that old line now, have you?
I've got nothing against humans, but, well, just imagine the tables were reversed. Would we dogs treat humans like this? Come on, Orville. Here's where you strut your stuff. Oh, good afternoon, miss. Exercising your human, I see. You mind if I pet her?
Why, no. Not a bit.
Say, she's a little beauty. Look at those shoulders. Oh, and that brisket. Get down, boy. Down, big fella.
My, but your human is obedient.
Understands every word I say. Watch. Sit up, boy.
Speak.
Play dead. Roll over.
Oh. Well, don't you wish you were that clever, darling?
Oh, that's nothing. Watch this. Go fetch it, boy. Go fetch it, boy. Get in there, you dumb mutt.
Oh, dear. Aren't you afraid he'll catch cold?
Nonsense. He loves every minute of it. Orville! Aren't you ashamed? Getting the nice lady's coat all dirty.
No, that's all right. It's an old one.
Tut-tut, you must have it cleaned. And send the bill to me. I insist. Yes, I do. I do indeed. Oh, and by the way, I know a little place around the corner if you're not busy this evening. The finest bones you've ever tasted.
Oh.
See what I mean?
We've no need for mongrels and radical ideas. Off with you, New. Off with you.
Okay. Hi, Eric Goldberg here. Even ideas that don't wind up on the cutting room floor may go through several different versions before arriving at the one that ultimately makes it into the film. Experimentation with dialogue and songs all must be worked out before animation can begin. Very often, temporary dialogue tracks will be recorded by actors who may not be the final voices for use in assembling the story reels. This is a good way for the artists to know if something is going to work before they go through the time-consuming animation process. As you might expect, some things work out better than others, and this process of fine-tuning leads to the final version used in the film. Let's take a look at an early version of a sequence that is in the final film, but in a much abbreviated form. For presentation on this DVD, we have reconstructed an alternate version of the sequence of the arrival of the baby. The voices for the first part of this sequence were recorded in 1953, 2 full years before the film was finished. The voice of the mother in this segment may sound familiar. It's Barbara Luddy, who ultimately provided the voice of Lady. The second half of this sequence is almost the final version. Peggy Lee provides the final voice of Darling. However, the vocals were accompanied by a simple piano track. The full orchestra would be added later. Note that she sings more lyrics to What is a Baby than those that ended up in the final film. And there's really nothing wrong with the performance or the idea. They really just decided to shorten this sequence to move the story along a little faster. Let's have a look.
When a baby moves in, the dog moves out.
La la loo, la la loo, dum de dum dum de da dum. I'll get this room done today, de dee dee dee. La la loo, la la loo, da da dee dee do dee do do. I'll make it pretty and gay today. Oh, la la loo, la 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 loo, la 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 loo, loo 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 loo. La da da da.
Lady, no no. No, 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 lady, go on. Don't! Look out! Look out, lady! Oh!
Da 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 da.
Darling?
Yes?
There isn't any way we can tell for sure what it's gonna be. Is there?
I'm afraid not, Jim, dear. Nobody ever knows for certain. All we can do is hope.
Yes, darling. Darling, are you sure you want watermelon?
Yes. Oh, and Jim, dear.
Yes?
Don't forget the chop suey.
Chops. All right, darling. Five, six, seven, eight, nine. See now, that'd be about, no, well, maybe, oh, well, April, anyhow.
Thank you.
is a baby anyway? Oh, what is a baby? I must find out today. What makes Jim dear and darling act this way? I am your mother, and I'm so glad you're here. You have a father who loves you oh so dear. We call you baby 'cause we don't know how to say that you are love that's come to live at our house today. La la loo, la la loo, oh my little star sweeper, I'll sweep the stardust for you. La la loo, la la loo, little soft fluffy sleeper, here comes a pink cloud for you. La la loo, la la loo, little wandering angel, fold up your wings, close your eyes. La la loo, la la loo, and may love be your keeper. La la loo, la la loo, la la loo. There now, little star sweeper, dream on.
Eric Goldberg here. Like most aspects of animated film production, the Siamese Cat song went through many stages of development before they felt they had it just right. Visual development explored different ways the cats might look. Not too silly, not too scary. They also tried different names, such as Flick and Flack and Nip and Tuck, before finally settling on Si and Am. Along the way, the artists experimented with many different ways the cats might torment poor little lady. And then there was the question of how the cats should sound. Let's take a look at some of these development ideas while we listen to a very rare set of original studio recordings from May 15th, 1953, which have just recently been uncovered. We'll hear two men, although not the actors pictured here, trying out different vocal personalities for the two Siamese cats, Si and Am. First, you'll hear a test of the opening verse where the performers tried singing in a higher pitch.
We are Siamese, if you please.
That will be followed by the second verse, sung in their normal range but performed very slowly, over-exaggerating the words.
If we sneaking up on it carefully.
This was done because they planned to play back the recordings at a faster speed to create the high-pitched character sound, which is what follows in the third part, where you will hear the rest of the song sped up by 30%.
There will be a head for you, a tail for me.
My voice, singing the melody, will be picked up on the second machine.
Of course, for the final film version, Peggy Lee, one of the song's composers, sang a duet with herself through the magic of overdubbing, which was a fairly new process in the early 1950s.
There are no finer cat than I am.
Let's take a look and listen.
Frontier
3,
take 1.
We are Siamese, if you please. We are Siamese, if you don't please. We are former resident of Siam. There are no finer cat than I am.
We are Siamese with very dainty paws. Please observing paws containing dainty claws. Now we're looking over our new domicile. If we like, we stay for maybe quite a while.
Do you seen that a thing swimming round and round?
Ah, yes. Maybe we could reaching in and make it drown.
Oh, yes, please.
If we sneaking upon it carefully, there will be a head for you,
a tail for me.
Do you hear what I hear?
Yes, I hear it a baby cry.
Oh, yes, and where we are finding baby,
there always are milk nearby.
Now, if we look in baby buggy, there will be plenty milk for you and plenty milk for me.
It's a beautiful night, and we call it Belle Adnoté. Look at the skies, they have stars in their eyes on this lovely Belle Adnoté. So take the love of your loved one. You'll need it about this time to keep from falling like a star when you make that dizzy climb. For this is the night and the heavens are bright on this lovely bed. When you make that dizzy climb, eh, mia e lasciarsi culla nell'incanto della notte. On this lovely bed
Welcome to the Disney Dogs board game. Disney dogs come in all shapes and sizes. They bark, they speak,
that's right,
they sing. To test your knowledge about the Disney dogs, select which version of the game you'd like to play now. You can play the single-player junior level mode or the multiplayer family. Ready to test your wit by yourself? Welcome to the single-player junior level mode. Here you'll be given 10 questions, and your goal is to answer each one of them without getting one wrong. Don't worry if you miss one, though, because we've got enough questions to keep you coming back again and again. Good luck! In The Fox and the Hound, when Copper grows up, what does his master teach him to do? Fetch the paper, roll over. Good work! In Beauty and the Beast, what handy item of furniture is the dog? A footstool, a lamp. Good answer. In 101 Dalmatians 2, what is Patch's favorite TV show? Great job. In the Muppet movie, Rolf plays what instrument? Drums, guitar, harp. Good answer. In 101 Dalmatians 2, who is Thunderbolt's sidekick? Lightning? Good work. In Lady and the Tramp, who does Lady save in the living room from the...
Canis familiaris, more commonly known as the dog. Noble, loyal, proud. For centuries, these canine companions have long since lived up to their reputations as man's best friend.
Oh, who are we kidding? They're just dogs. Hi, I'm Fred Willard. We're here at a local dog park to learn all about dogs. Oh, left that. Oh, well. You know, these beautiful animals have been around for literally millions of years, so I think we should start out with a brief history to get you up to speed.
Many scientists believe that all dogs are descendants of wolves. Yes, even you, little guy. It's also believed that dogs became pets more than 10,000 years ago. Salukis and greyhounds are among the oldest known dog breeds. They were bred by the ancient Egyptians for protection and to help hunt for food.
I love a story with food in it.
Today, dogs come in all shapes and sizes. like most dogs, over 150 different breeds are grouped into just 7 categories. These groups are sporting, hound, terrier, toy, non-sporting, herding, and working.
Oh, you again. This dog wants very much to be on television. He claims he can do a fantastic trick. Can you sit up and put your paws like that? Well, you can. All right, thank you very much. We're seeing a lot of dogs today. Okay, good. Thank you.
And now the sporting group. Guess what? Lady's a sporting dog. In fact, she's a Cocker Spaniel. But I'll bet you already knew that.
Ooh, and we're all very impressed.
These dogs play a lot more than just fetch. They also play basketball. Well, we know at least one that does. But above all, they love to hunt. Sporting dogs were originally bred to fetch and bring back fallen game.
We was only having a bit of sport, we was.
The loyalty and friendship of sporting dogs is truly beyond compare.
Now, this looks like the kind of dog you'd see pulling a bobsled.
Miniature bobsled.
Are they less expensive when they're small?
She cost me about $2,200.
Wow. Woof! Woof! I must not be speaking her language.
And now, the hound group.
I'm a hound dog.
Hound dogs' expert tracking abilities have been helping humans for hundreds of years. Some hounds track better with sight, while others prefer smell. Hounds that track using sight have great vision and include fast running dogs like greyhounds. Greyhounds are so fast, they can reach speeds up to 45 miles per hour. All dogs have a great sense of smell, but hounds that track by scent have some of the best sniffers in the world.
I think I'm on to something.
If a pot of stew is cooking on the stove, we can smell the stew. But most dogs can smell the beef, carrots, potatoes, and all the other individual ingredients.
Hey, where are you going?
I want to find out what that smell is.
Can you smile for the camera? Can you smile? These dogs are so clean looking. Are they washable, or do you send them out to the dry cleaners, or what? No, like just a smile. There you go. And here's the ball. There you go.
Labradors.
I lost the. Can you smile?
This is her best side, actually.
Yes, yes. That's true for a lot of us.
Get ready for the terrier group. Dogs in this group are usually feisty, energetic, and thrive on attention. They love to chase and hunt and are fantastic diggers. Terriers were originally bred to hunt rats and other small vermin. But although they're fiercely loyal to their families, they don't get along too well with other animals.
Mongrel!
But don't let their small size fool you. They are strong, active, and surprisingly agile.
It's a wee bit slippery.
Terriers often have a strong personality and usually have a stubborn streak to match.
Off with you, Noo! Off with you! Off with you!
But behind that rough exterior lies a heart of gold.
Now, does she do any particular tricks?
If you drop a piece of food and then you tell her to leave it, she won't touch it. She won't even look at it.
Wow, that's a tough trick.
Now, I'm going to put that down and tell you to leave it.
Just leave it. She's doing it, yeah.
Now you can eat it.
No, she just didn't care for it either way. So there you go. I wouldn't eat it myself. Does he mix well with other dogs?
Oh, yeah. Well, he's not neutered, so.
Neutered? No, I'm not sure. What does a neutered mean? Oh, good heavens. Well, aren't you a lucky dog?
And now, the toy group. Toy dogs have been considered symbols of status and wealth throughout civilization. This group represents the smallest of all dogs. Chihuahuas and pugs are just a couple of popular toy-sized versions of man's best friend.
Cute little rascals.
Toy dogs have it easy. Their main job is to keep their owners entertained. They are ideal dogs for living in crowded cities where space is hard to come by. But don't let their small size fool you. Many toy dogs are tough as nails.
Come on, man, you guys don't scare me. Come on, I'll kill your boys, man. Come on.
I think it's safe to say that these dogs definitely bark much bigger than they bite.
Well, here's a dog that looks exactly like the Tramp. I think I scared her a bit. What's her name?
Susie.
Susie, hi, Susie. Oh. Don't you bite me, I've got a microphone.
Yeah, you're
I'll badmouth
aren't you?
You for days. Where did you girls get that mouse? Oh, it's not a mouse. It's a little...
Hey!
Look at me. Why?
And
I should pretend I'm scared. Wait a minute. I'm determined to make this dog love me. He's taken to me, I can tell. Oh, I don't even want to pet him. There you go, nice dog. Nice dog, okay.
Coming up next, the non-sporting group. Poodles, Dalmatians, and Bulldogs are a couple of the more popular dogs in the non-sporting group. These dogs may have formerly been bred to work or hunt, but now are raised primarily as house pets.
I really am.
The non-sporting group is very diverse. It contains big dogs, small dogs, dogs with lots of hair, and some with very little. Speaking of hair, did you know that Dalmatians are born with pure white hair?
No spots! No spots at all! What a horrid little white rat!
They'll have their spots in a few weeks.
She's right, Cruella. Dalmatian spots won't appear until about 2 weeks after they're born.
Little rascal, let's go.
Let's see. This is, what kind of dog is this?
She's a miniature dachshund.
Miniature dachshund. How do you get them so long? Do you get them warm and stretch them? And she's like
her?
A little hot dog, isn't she?
Yeah, she is.
Yeah. Put a little mustard on her and put her between some buns.
Very
what kind is
friends.
That? That's a strange...
He's a pug.
Don't be bashful. I mean, some people think that's a beautiful face. Iron those wrinkles right out. He'd look delightful.
Bringing it in with the herding group. Collies and sheepdogs are a couple of the dogs that make up the herding group. Herding dogs are fiercely loyal and protective. One collie once traveled over 2,000 miles to find his family after he became lost.
By George!
Another unique characteristic of dogs in this group is their uncanny ability to control the movement of other animals.
Come along, Tibbs, on the double!
Yes, sir. Righto, sir.
A single sheepdog can drive an entire flock of sheep across a countryside all by himself. Dogs in the herding group are agile, swift, good jumpers, and most importantly, very intelligent.
And of course, who could forget this famous scene? I mean, just look at them.
Oh, last but not least, the working group. Some dogs are known for their loyalty. Some for their playfulness, others their intelligence. But the working breed, they're best known for their bravery. The St. Bernard, for instance, has rescued more than 2,000 mountain travelers. In fact, his sense of smell is so excellent that he can find a person even under many feet of snow. Dogs from this group are also unusually big and strong.
Why don't you pick on someone your own size?
For hundreds of years, working dogs have also been of great assistance to law enforcement. Another working dog, the Doberman Pinscher, was first bred by Louis Doberman, a German tax collector who needed a bodyguard.
It's party time.
Working group dogs make great companions thanks to their courage and unselfish nature.
Well, it's been quite a day at the dog park. You call it a day gone to the dogs. And my thanks to all the dogs who participated. This is Fred Willard saying love your dog. Say goodbye. To the world's tiniest dog. We hope you don't get lost out here in the park, and we hope nobody steps on you. This will make him look larger. See? Now that's a big dog. That's pretty big, huh? He's as big as he can be.
Just as each Disney dog has its own distinctive personality, each of us has a distinctive personality too. Get in touch with your inner dog by taking the following quiz to see which Lady and the Tramp canine you resemble most. What would you most like to do on a farm? Chase. A fly is buzzing around your head. It's raining outside. Do you run? You really have. What would you? You are just like Jock, a Scottish Terrier. Charming and dignified, you are also brave, energetic, and very aware of what's going on around you. Friends are charmed by you, and in turn, you make a true friend. You love to have fun, as long as it's respectable fun. Thank you.
The world of Lady and the Tramp is, in many ways, Walt's world.
When Walt was doing Lady and the Tramp, Marceline was very much on his mind.
This was the world that Walt Disney grew up in.
Disney family came to Marceline from Chicago, where Walt was born, and Elias wanted to get his family out of the city.
Marceline, Missouri must have been quite a strange environment for Walt when he first arrived there.
Coming from Chicago, from a big city, coming in on the railroad, getting on a horse and buggy and riding a few miles out into what must seem like the boondocks at the time to live on a farm.
He just automatically fell in love with Marceline because of the mice and the rats and the stuff that he could see on the farm that he loved. And in fact, he had a tree that he called his dream tree.
It's this huge cottonwood tree that Walt found inspirational. As a child, he would go lie beneath its branches and he would listen to the sound tinkling in the leaves. He would observe all of nature around him, and that's where he first started to draw. Even as an adult, when Walt came back here for a trip, he would ask for time alone for inspiration underneath his dreaming tree.
He was a railroad buff, and of course, Marceline was a railroad town at that time.
Walt's love for the railroad started right here in Marceline. Every time Walt came back to Marceline, he would come on a train. And if you look at the movie Lady and the Tramp, where was Tramp? Right there, by the railroad. When he came back in 1956 to dedicate the Walt Disney Swimming Pool and Park, he looked at the crowd that day at the Uptown Theater and he says, you know, you children are lucky to live in Marceline. My best memories are the years I spent here.
When you grow up and leave a place that meant something to you, and then when you come back, it just sort of all washes over you.
And I think when you look at a film like Lady and the Tramp, it captures some of that. It captures who Walt Disney is. Here's a guy in his mid-50s who has had a fantastic career making short cartoons and then became the talk of the town by making Snow White and the great movies of the golden age of animation. And now he's going back to something that perhaps we all do in the middle of our lives, which is kind of looking where we came from and looking what made us who we are.
In 1955, Rosa Parks refused to sit in the back of the bus, the beginning of the civil rights movement. Lolita was a bestseller. There were nuclear warheads that were being tested in the country at that time. All of these social and political upheavals were going on, and yet Walt Disney presents his own nostalgic vision of what America can or should be.
Hello there, lady.
Who knows if Marceline, Missouri was as beautiful and as poetically conceived as the world of Lady and the Tramp, but he brought an extra level of artistry and color and some wistful sense of an America that really ceased to exist a long time ago.
When he was living there, it was the period when the high street was suddenly paved and cars began to come in and the world began to change. And Lady and the Tramp, in a sense, is about that world that's just about to change. You see just a few hints there. The telephones, there are hints of the automobile. It's still the old world, but it's not going to be that way much longer.
And I feel in Lady and the Tramp, you get to see a little bit of that middle America, that idyllic place where the laundry on the line is a little bit brighter and the dappled light through the trees is a little bit more magical than maybe in real life. You certainly see it at Disneyland.
Now we want you to share with us our latest and greatest dream, Disneyland.
He opened Disneyland 1 month after premiering Lady and the Tramp, and it's kind of interesting. There's this cross-pollination. They both have a small town feel to them, particularly the Main Street entrance to Disneyland, the whole prosperous but small town setting for Lady and the Tramp.
It gave Walt a chance to show a little bit of himself, to say, I'm not off in Never Never Land, I'm not in Cinderella's castle, I'm in my own hometown. And I think that's why it's near and dear to audiences and has been ever since.
Right now, I want you to meet the stars of our latest dog picture. Lady and the Tramp.
For a movie based on dogs, about dogs, all from a dog's point of view, it's probably the most human story he's ever told.
It's a little bit like a soap opera, actually, you know. Boy gets girl, boy loses girl, boy gets girl at the end.
And watching that unfold, it's hard to believe it actually took so long to actually get it up on the movie screen.
Now, Lady and the Tramp has really been a fun picture to make. It was an original story to start with, and as we made the picture and got to know the characters, we kept getting new ideas.
There's a lot of confusion about how Lady and the Tramp actually got to be made.
I honestly don't know much about the story.
I don't really know the historical record of the movie.
Well, you'll have to ask somebody who knows the picture real well.
It's especially difficult now to find out the truth because it was made so long ago.
What we really do know for sure is that the story of Lady and the Tramp started in the late 1930s with the legendary Joe Grant.
He was hired in 1933 originally as a caricaturist.
About that time they were making Three Little Pigs. When he saw Three Little Pigs first being animated, he thought, wow, this is a business I wanted to be in.
I think Walt sensed the great creativity because my father was also a writer as well as an artist.
His first real notice for a Disney audience would be The Witch in Snow White. He designed that hag.
Walt really trusted Joe Grant, and he was a great influence on many, many films at Disney.
He'd be the igniter of films, little ideas that would start entire features.
He and his wife had a Cocker Spaniel.
A Springer Spaniel?
A Cocker Spaniel.
Right?
A Springer Spaniel.
A Springer Spaniel.
Cocker Spaniel named Lady.
Just to set the record straight, Joe's dog was a Springer Spaniel, white and brown all over. Lady is a Cocker Spaniel. She's honey-colored all over.
She was a beautiful, beautiful dog. But when I was born, Lady was shifted aside a bit.
Joe Grant did a single drawing of his dog, and he had Walt over for dinner one night. Walt was charmed by it. He just loved the way the spaniel's coat was sort of like a little skirt on the dog.
And he said, Joe, why don't you do a storyboard on that?
And so that's how the story started.
He wove it into this charming story about Spaniel being sort of replaced by the baby's arrival.
The story didn't have Tramp in it. It had just the antics of a dog around the house getting the paper.
And then there's also a mean mother-in-law who comes in with a couple of cats. All of these elements were there in Joe Grant's story.
From the 1930s up to the early 1940s, countless Disney artists and story artists and writers worked on Joe's story of this dog, Lady. One version had Lady having two suitors. One was a Russian wolfhound named Boris, and the other one was a mongrel named Homer. Also, all the action took place inside of Lady's house, and the major conflict was about Lady and these two cats and an evil rat.
It wasn't until 1943 that Walt saw it for the first time in storyboard form.
Walt hated it. He just hated it, and really the problem was Lady herself.
Lady's a charmer. She is a lovely, lovely dog. And Walt knew that just charm and loveliness alone does not a story make.
That was it. They were stuck. They put the project on hold, back on the shelf, and a lot of animated projects die on the vine at exactly that stage.
That could have been the end of Lady and the Tramp. But luckily, that wasn't the case.
One day, Walt read a story in Cosmopolitan magazine called Happy Dan, the Cynical Dog, and it was written by a man named Ward Green. Now, you have to understand, Cosmopolitan wasn't Cosmo then. It wasn't Makeup Tips and all that kind of stuff. It was a literary magazine, and it had about 2 million subscribers. The problem for the longest time was that Lady herself was too soft. So Walt thought if he took this cynical dog and brought him into contact with Lady, poof, fireworks.
Walt was a master at that, knowing when he's got something good, and knowing when he's got something great.
Unfortunately, World War II intervened, and the war years were very tough on the Disney studio.
And Walt really had to scale back in terms of animated filmmaking. He couldn't do the features anymore. They were too costly.
And it wasn't really until the 1950s with Cinderella that they got back on track again. The big difference with Lady and the Tramp is that it wasn't based, like many of Walt's best-loved films, on a fairy tale or a book that people already knew and loved.
I think as a filmmaker, it must have been so liberating for them to create great characters and tell a story that's not so bound by a fairy tale or by some source material.
One of the last decisions to be made was, what are we going to call this cynical dog? So there were various suggestions, Homer or Rags or even Bozo. So how about Lady and the Bozo? Yeah, that really, really has a good ring to it.
Walt decided at some point the male dog should be called Tramp. And there was a lot of discussion at the studio about, oh, I don't think we can call it that. That's kind of a, that has a connotations of something else.
He's a tramp. He's a scoundrel.
But Walt went ahead with his own version, bullheaded, as always.
At this point, Joe Grant was no longer at the studio.
Joe Grant was top of the line in terms of people that Walt went to for ideas and trusted at the studio. But at one point, they had a falling out.
Joe was a big story man on Alice in Wonderland. And one of the things that Walt said to me was, I didn't want to make Alice in Wonderland. Some of my staff talked me into it. It was Joe Grant who was one of the ones that talked him into it. So Joe leaves the studio in 1949.
And Daddy really missed it. And he said, well, life's changed.
One thing that still kind of nagged at Walt was that they were still making this story up completely from scratch. So he asked Ward Green to do a novelized version, which came out in 1953.
So at that point, it was really Ward Green's story that became the main source material for the film, and Joe Grant's earlier version was pretty much ignored.
They sort of cut Joe's contribution out of it. I don't think he even gets credit in the film itself.
The one that didn't like it the most was my mother. She was very Irish and very upset, because that was our story.
As if all this weren't enough, they put it about that Walt actually gave his wife a puppy in a hat box. So it's the kind of thing where that then became the official spark that generated the movie Lady and the Tramp.
I've heard this, and I know Joe goes,
whether Walt gave Lily the puppy in the hat box or didn't give Lily the puppy in the hat box, he knew that the story was a good one to fit with the creation of Lady and the Tramp.
The final film is charming, wonderful, and evocative of a simpler time in America's history. But that simpler time really is just a background for what I think is one of Walt's most complex and adult films.
It's a love story about two different kinds of people from two different worlds.
Well, that's what comes of tying yourself down to one family.
After a tramp shows Lady the town and all the exciting things that she doesn't know about, they sort of settle in for the night and the camera dissolves and then the camera comes up again and it's morning. And you kind of wonder what happened there. You know, it's a little risque. Maybe too many people don't think about that, but most likely, you know, they had a romantic night.
That was probably one of the toughest things they had to figure out. How can we get away with this? Lady's going to give birth to pups at the end of this movie, but how do we breach that subject? Well, they really do it cleverly with Jock and Trusty coming over the next day.
But I've never even considered matrimony.
It all gets into this very adult subtext, certainly in live action, that had been dealt with many, many times. But to bring that into a sort of Disney animated children's movie, obviously they walked a fine line there, and I think they walked that line beautifully.
And when I heard they'd taken you to the pound...
Oh, don't even mention that horrible place.
I love animated features that will go to the hard truth.
Hey, you guys, look. Poor Nutsy has taken the law. long walk.
Dogs go down. Hard truth.
I think the only way that they could take sort of the edge of the idea of that scene is by showing it in shadow.
The danger is there, the death is there, but it's deflected and it's not direct.
Where is he taking him?
Shut a one-way door, sister.
That dog goes down because later Tramp's gonna be heading there by the same guys hauling him right to that same gate.
So you know when Tramp is being caught by the dog catcher, he's in serious danger.
By the time you reach the end of the story, when Trusty and Jock are in pursuit, it starts moving so fast that you're almost shocked when you get to the end.
I thought as a kid that he was dead. I mean, I was really bawling because I thought, well, he's not going to live. You know, of course not. Look at this. He's dead.
Originally, Trusty was supposed to die. And Mother just was devastated, and she said it will upset the children much too much. And she sort of fought for it.
Careful now, man.
I think the audience could have handled that dog dying. In fact, it would have added a little more weight and a little more love for Trusty in the long run.
Oh, no doubt about it. They've got their mother's eyes.
Joe Grant, we said, what's the take home? What is the audience going to talk about in the car on the way home?
You had such rich characters that you loved. And that's what you took home with you.
It wasn't until his wife passed away in the mid-80s that Joe joined the studio again and contributed amazing ideas to films like Lion King and Pocahontas.
Things like the leaves swirling around Pocahontas.
My mother said, Carol, how would you like to get up every day of your life and do the thing you love most all day long? And that's my father.
I don't think Joe ever felt he was going to pass away or die, and I don't think any of us ever felt he would.
In 2005, Joe Grant did pass away at the age of 97.
The film came out almost 50 years ago, and Joe thought about the idea even earlier. So it's nice that now, after all this time, people know that it was Joe who really came up with the idea.
Now, we've had a lot of requests from people who want to know how we put our pictures together. So for this part of the program, I want to give you an idea of how we went about making Lady and the Tramp.
Lady and the Tramp had the animation crew at a point where, I don't want to say at their peak because they did fantastic things afterwards, but their work had gotten so refined by the mid-50s, they could really animate anything beautifully, anything.
Oh. I love the animation in this film because it's so observed. Looking at dogs, the way they're rolling around and laying, you know, everyone who has dogs knows those poses. That's what dogs do. In the 50s, there was a group of animators that Walt considered his key animators, and he called them the Nine Old Men.
The Nine Old Men really became the key players who continued on for decades, really, and shaped the Disney style and helped Walt telling his stories and really animated all of the films.
Those were the guys that were there and did it, and so they deserved the credit that they got, and they were all unique.
You see completely different drawing styles. Because people might think that, oh, everybody at Disney would have to draw the same, because it looks so even in the final film, but they didn't draw the same.
Animation is really the best when it's when you concentrate on the details. At how a character does something, and you create a character. That's when we're at our best.
One of the things my dad and other animators do is they just observe life and see how things go, and that's why the animation is so realistic.
And being a dog picture, we naturally looked at a lot of dogs, and they were a mighty appealing bunch.
Certainly they studied dogs a lot in the movie, and they captured the movement of dogs just perfectly.
You do have to do a lot of studying to learn how they walk, what leg they put down before the other one, how do their shoulders work.
It needs to be clear which leg the weight is on. And what you do as an animator, you push the shoulder up. It's always interesting to see how Walt paired the animator for a certain character. Walt loved to pair Frank Thomas with Milt Kahl.
Let's look in on Milt Kahl, who's been teaming up with Frank Thomas on Lady and the Tramp right from the start of the picture.
Milt was, of course, known for his incredible draftsmanship.
Milt Kahl was primarily responsible for the animation of Tramp. He brings a lot of macho qualities to Tramp, devil may care qualities that Milt Kahl had himself.
Well, first we thought of the Tramp with one black eye. Thought he'd be kind of cute. Sort of a tough little guy from across the tracks.
One of his masterpieces in the movie is when we see Tramp for the first time.
There's a scene where he kind of wakes in the morning and he stretches. And the stretch is so extreme. You feel tension and the bones popping.
There's a section where he's imitating the humans and he changes from a realistically drawn dog into this wonderful caricature that's part dog, part human.
Stop that racket, you'll wake the baby!
It just is a magical sequence there, the way he exaggerates the animation and pulls it back. Great control, but yet great letting go.
Animators are performers or actors with a pencil. You know, even though there's a lot of drawing involved, but the drawing is secondary. It's not as important as the performance, as the movement and the feeling that you have to have.
There probably never has been an artist who is more naturally suited to putting emotion into animation than Frank Thomas was.
This is Frank Thomas, one of our key animators.
If you look back on the scenes that Frank did, not everybody would have done them with the wonderful acting ability and life.
I'm very, very soft.
Frank came up with those scenes where Tramp is introduced to the other dogs.
Jock is trying to make him shoo away, get this riffraff to go away. And there's this attitude and feistiness to him.
And we've no need for mongrels and radical ideas. Off with you, Noob! Off with you! Off with you!
Okay. You know, you have to think about, well, what am I going to have this dog do to, in a dog way, say, get that, get out of here, blow it off, you know? And I think it's a great example of Frank finding just the right timing and nuance in a performance.
All right, let's see what we got.
This is right about, well, so Lady and the Tramp was in production when this was going on.
Right, and Frank was observing every dog in the neighborhood.
Do you remember how long Dad was working on Lady and the Tramp?
Oh, dear. 3 years?
Something that Frank in particular was so strong on was taking everything he saw around him. That's a good slow motion study on
the
dog.
That's probably why he did it.
And somehow taking the essence of that gesture, the essence of that feeling, and putting it into whatever character he was working on. So you were operating the camera on this.
I must have.
And because he was animating dogs, he got to wash the dog. Mm-hmm. But I noticed that when it comes to dry the dog, that's your job.
Frank always thought he wasn't a good draftsman. He really said, I just don't draw that well. But his search was there, and the analysis that he put into it created beautiful drawings. Ollie Johnson is the opposite. He gets himself almost into a state of mind where he feels very deeply what the character is going through, and then that would tell him how to animate the character.
Ollie had a very delicate light touch in his drawings. Some of these lines just almost disappear, very just kind of feathering the paper with the pencil. Very different from Frank, who would just sculpt and carve it into the paper.
Ollie Johnson is really the last of Walt's 9 old men, so I take time out whenever I can to see Ollie and talk to him. Ollie pretty much focused on Lady and going through her frustrations when the baby arrives, you know, and she talks to the other dogs about it. And that's very insightful animation because you really have to read the inner feelings of the character.
He's never called me that before.
Well, now, lassie, I wouldn't have worried my wee head about that.
Walt depended on Wooly Reitherman to do the fight sequences or the action sequences because he was really good at staging them.
We could get a good dramatic effect here by having part of the fight behind the barrels and have shadows of the dogs cast on the wall.
I was probably between 3, 4, 5 years old, and not being in school, I used to hang out with my dad a lot So one day, my dad and a few of the other animators were going over this scene of the alley fight in Lady and the Tramp. And I remember they got one of these gooseneck lamps to kind of create a shadow on the wall, and then the guys got on the floor and started tussling and kind of, you know, one or two would watch the other two guys and trying to see how the shadows went on the wall, and they were just trying to get all the kinds of antics they could do to make something a fight, but not a cruel fight, but kind of a schoolyard kind of fight.
What if he bit the big curl on the leg like this? Starts down here at the bottom, works his way right up the top.
Wooly was so good at creating those really powerful, iconic visual images on screen.
I know that my dad often approached these scenes from the point of view of the thing he knew was going to lose the fight, and then try to not make that happen. You just can't help but be a little squirm when you watch these things, because you really don't know how they're going to turn out.
See that lightning flashing, and that rat is looking down and about ready to jump on that baby. It's like, that's as horrifying an image as you can possibly get on screen.
All right, you guys. Lay off, will you?
What's the matter, Peg?
Oh, can't you see the poor kid's scared enough already?
Eric Larson, I think that probably some of his best work on this movie. He did Peg, and I found this very fun photograph that was taken during the making of Lady and the Tramp in the 50s. And here we have this big superstar, Peggy Lee, visiting Eric. And you can just see how bashful he is showing her his work, you know, and he's maybe even a little bit smitten by her. I think it's all in here.
He was a Mormon, and he said he always got chided for how he was able to animate this very sexy little gal doing this song.
Gives you plenty of trouble.
When Eric Larson told the story of animating He's a Tramp, he would explain that it was the happiest experience that he ever had as an animator.
He's hanging out with Peggy Lee on this movie and doing a sexy performance of this pooch, and I think, wow, an animator can do anything.
Now, here you are, the best spaghetti in a town.
Storytelling, often, we know where it's headed in a way, don't we? But the trick of it is to pay it off in a unique way. In a love story, we know that people are going to fall in love, but how do they fall in love?
Oh, this is the night. It's a beautiful night.
I think the spaghetti sequence is a great example of great acting, because what that sequence is all about really is not two dogs eating spaghetti. It's about two dogs falling in love.
And a romantic section with subtle acting needs to be handled very carefully. So the drawing has to be right on the money. I don't know that anybody else could have pulled this off like Frank Thomas did. I mean, he was the guy.
When it was on storyboards and Walt saw it, Walt didn't like it, or at least he didn't think it would work.
I imagine that when he thought of dogs eating spaghetti, you know, it's gonna flop up, and what's romantic about that? It's silly, it's ridiculous.
So Frank took it on his own. He worked out the basic animation and it actually showed it to Walt to sell him on it.
He had that in his head. He just had to actually do it before other people could see it that way.
Aren't we grateful that Frank actually persisted, right? That he didn't listen to Walt. He said, no, I'm going to make this work, and I'll show him. I'll show him that it's going to be entertaining.
You'll find I'm a chant a man to hear. The night will weave its magic spell.
So, Ollie, when you look back over movies like Lady and the Tramp and some of the others, do you feel a sense of pride?
Oh, sure.
That you've accomplished something really important?
Yeah.
People like me can only be grateful because all this inspires us to keep going, you know. So for all that, I want to thank you.
Well, thank you very much. It's been my pleasure.
People often ask us where we get the songs for our pictures, how we decide what songs we want to use, and how we go about working them into our stories.
Disney had a tremendous appreciation of music.
La la loo, la la loo.
In all of his films, practically, music has a very, very important role.
The way they use music almost to replace sound effects and to tell the story with audio.
It doesn't overpower the animation. Everything works very well together.
music in an animated film usually takes two distinct forms, the actual background score of the movie and the songs themselves. In this case, the score was written by the great Oliver Wallace, and the songs, very infectious, written by Peggy Lee and Sonny Burke.
Lady and the Tramp is not a film that is overrun with songs. What this did is that it gave Wallace a lot of space to write original material. You can't undercut the Ollie Wallace kind of contribution to the film.
Almost the entire first 15 minutes of the film is mostly Wallace. Oliver Wallace was born in England in 1887 and came to, actually, Canada in 1903.
Before joining Disney in the late 1930s, he had worked as a film accompanist. Remember, this is the time when films were still mostly silent. His first major score for Walt Disney was for Dumbo, which won an Academy Award.
And he continued doing 100 films with Disney, including Cinderella, Alice in Wonderland, Peter Pan, and his last major project, Lady and the Tramp. The thing he probably picked up from accompanying silent films is he wrote transitions so beautifully. And in the song, it's almost this lyric tenor, but it's very American. It feels like New England.
It's a romantic, very simple story. And the music is also very romantic.
It is so of the time, and it's like a little time capsule. You can really travel back and enjoy that kind of musical style from that period.
It's something we're very familiar and comfortable with. Following this, we go into the house, and he changes harmony where Darling first picks up the dog.
Oh, how sweet.
Oliver Wallace was just a master at this. One thing he picked up was the notion of marching bands. I think it was in his blood, perhaps being English-born. You see it actually in Lady's theme, which develops very slowly and, you know, piece by piece. For instance, you can hear the underlying da-da-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-bum. So we're getting little pieces of her theme there. You don't get the feeling necessarily that it's a march. You just get this feeling of this kind of exuberance. It allows us a window into that Victorian time where bands marched on streets and there was an excitement about that, and going to a silent film was an event.
After World War II, Disney started drawing more and more on popular songwriters and popular performers for his films.
You probably know Peggy Lee as a singer and an actress. But Peggy is also a talented lyricist, so she and Sonny Burke, the well-known musician and composer, were called in to discuss the song possibilities.
This is a chance to bring in a very popular music star to not only collaborate with the songs and write the songs, but also to do several voices in the film.
Ultimately, she wound up doing 4 different voices, the voice of Mrs. Darling, the mother, and the voice of Peg, which she was so delighted with, and the voice of Cy and Am, the Siamese cats.
There's a spot here where the cats get Lady into trouble.
Ooh, they are a couple of villains, aren't they?
Walt suggested we tell the whole sequence with a song.
Well, that sounds like fun. Why don't we start with this one?
Good.
Sonny Burke worked with people like Ella Fitzgerald and Mel Torme. Sonny Burke also became very well known later, working at both Decca and Reprise as a producer and working on numerous Frank Sinatra albums.
Dad and Peggy had become really good friends at Decca. Working together, they developed a rapport based around humor and music.
Hi, Nikki. How are you?
Mother was delighted to be asked to work on anything for Walt Disney because she had great respect for him and with somebody of the stature of Sonny Burke.
Now, this is exactly how I saw them working at our house.
That's right.
We would hear the piano playing down below, and we would sneak to the banister, and you could hear the songs from Lady and the Tramp as they were being created.
We are Siamese, if you please.
What Peggy Lee brought to that moment was just listen to those words. They're so brilliant.
There are no finer cat than I am.
It's almost like Yoda kind of speak, you know, the way they, strange placement of words, and which makes it more chilling.
Now we're looking over our new domicile. If we like, we stay for maybe quite a while.
Oh, and he's pointing to Peg.
Oh.
The character that was named after Mama.
He's laughing like that. Peg was an unforeseen addition to the movie.
Yes.
And they had really almost done what they were going to do before they hit on the idea of having a character named Peg.
Oh, she was so delighted with it. She really had fun with it.
What a dog.
Peg in the movie vamps it up, picking up on all the cues from your mom.
He's a tramp, but they love him. Breaks a new heart every day. He's a tramp, they adore him. And I only hope he'll stay that way.
The whole sequence in the Dog Pound plays almost like a vaudeville stage show.
It not only is musical, it's comedy, and it's drama, all in one little 3-4 minute segment.
But I love him. Yes, even I have got it pretty bad. You can never tell.
That's the best for a Disney geek like me, and that's Nirvana, man. Watching that Eric Larson animation of Peg's face and the Mellow Men is the music group in the background.
The Mellow Men are really one of the highlights of this film. They were actually a very accomplished and well-known group in Hollywood. But to listen to them in this, it just sounds like a bunch of dogs howling.
There's nothing more to say.
The marriage of animation and music has always been a hallmark of the best Disney films. And this one's no exception.
Wish that I could travel his way. Wish that I could travel his way.
Ever chase chickens?
I should say not.
No fussing. I know my way around.
I don't imagine anything could ever take her place in our hearts.
The voice talent is a huge part of what makes these shows work. And in Lady and the Tramp, they had some terrific people to deal with.
Lady and the Tramp is really an ensemble piece. It's like a little repertory company of voices.
And then the voices you tend to recall are, in some ways, the cameos.
Oh, can't you see the poor kid scared enough already?
Pay no attention, my little Ochichornia.
When you watch that film, you'll never see a movie with more dialects in your life.
Animators love working with accents because accents mean immediate character.
Hey, Joe, look who's here.
Well, what do you know? It's a butch.
It's not about ethnicity. It's about having fun with a non-native English speaker, I guess, but in a joyful sort of way, I think.
You run into these great dogs, the Russian with a Russian accent.
He's happy.
And an English bulldog.
Debutante.
And a Mexican chihuahua.
Rosita, chiquita, Juanita, chihuahua.
And they all have great little moments of voice acting that really brings them to life.
Don't recollect if I've ever mentioned Old Reliable before.
Aye, you have, laddie. Frequently.
Oh, yeah.
I was the voice of Christopher Robin in Winnie the Pooh and the Honey Tree, the first Winnie the Pooh short, and then I was the voice of Mowgli in The Jungle Book. And I can tell you from personal experience that it's not easy to act when you have nothing but a microphone to act to. The voices are always recorded first. The animation happens to the voice.
Darling is expecting a wee bairn.
Bairn?
He means a baby, Miss Lady.
Oh. What's a baby?
That's good. Say Barbara.
Barbara Luddy was close to 50 when she did the voice of Lady. Interestingly enough, Larry Roberts, the guy who did the voice of Tramp, was in his late 20s. So it shows it doesn't matter what the actors look like in real life, it's how the animators portray them and what they get out of the nuances out of the voice.
It didn't hurt, really, but darling has never struck me before.
I can remember being with my dad for one reason or another and having them perk up in the room when they realized that an actor on the soundstage had just given them something. Where's my felt pen? How can I get a quick sketch in to capture that little bit of sound that's gonna be a personality?
Oh, merciful heavens! My darlings, my precious pets!
Verna Felton was in her 60s when she did this recording, and she was a veteran voice actress for Disney. She had a warmth to her voice, a motherly, matronly, motherly quality, but she could also be bombastic as well.
Oh, with fireheads!
Disney was great at casting in these subsidiary roles, talent, and then animating great, great pictures to them.
Let me see here.
The voice of the beaver is just great.
6'6" and 7/16".
One day I got a call from a wonderful casting director, Jack Lavin, at Disney, and said, Stan, we got something Walt thinks you'll be perfect for. We're doing a movie called Lady and the Tramp, and we want you to do the voice of the beaver.
You could come up with a lot of different voices that are kind of goofy or funny or unique, but what's the one that really has the essence of beaver about it? Well, it's the one that's silly and supercilious.
Busy, Sonny, busy.
Walt Disney paid me the respect of letting me develop the voice, and he didn't give me very much guidance except coming up with the idea of the whistle through his teeth.
You don't say.
And sometimes I was able to do it and sometimes not. So it was Walt's idea that the sound effects man and my friend Jimmy McDonald got me this little whistle.
66%, eh? Think of that. Well, how's it work?
So here's the way it worked. Well, Sonny, we'll have to settle on the price. Say, that works. One more time. One more time, Walt. Say, that works swell. And that's how it worked.
You have seen how we make the cartoons move and talk. Now, like all actors, they must have backgrounds to work in.
This was the first CinemaScope widescreen animated movie.
CinemaScope was a totally new format. And yet, here they were using it for very traditional subject matter.
What you see in Lady and the Tramp is a beautifully detailed, real Victorian world.
It's almost like an animated Norman Rockwell painting. It has that detail and this Americana styling to it.
It's a dreamlike landscape, and I think it's something you can only do with a paintbrush and some really, really brilliant artists.
The mid-50s were an interesting time because TV had just come in, which was the new medium that was supposed to kill movies.
A lot of theater owners were wondering, how are we going to compete? Movies are going to go away, and everybody's going to just watch films in their living room. So what's special? And that's when you got things like Cinerama, like big wraparound screens, and you also got CinemaScope, which was a widescreen but could be shown in virtually any theater with a change of a lens.
CinemaScope set up a new set of demands for the backgrounds. They had to be interesting all the way across.
When you look at the backgrounds, they create pools of light and softness where the action's going to play. And that's a discipline, because every artist that I know wants to have their work coming forward.
Of all the Disney background artists, Claude Coates was a master at creating detail without distracting you. You're always looking at the character.
It's hard to describe all the things that go into making a great background artist like Claude was, because you're both the lighting designer, you're the scenic designer, and in some ways you're the cinematographer. And I think Claude was a master at doing all of those things.
I love how haunting this feels. There's just a definite sort of scary mood in this, the way these buildings are angled. It's all a little bit off and not real, but it just adds to a certain mood.
Most animated films, before they even have a script, have an idea that needs to be conceptualized. And there are inspirational sketch artists who do that. And one of the greatest was Mary Blair.
Mary Blair was a fascinating artist because she had her own way of suggesting little vignettes of stage characters.
There are wonderful watercolor paintings by Mary Blair that depict Lady in certain situations that were from the original treatment. These are some early watercolors. Here's Lady out in a snowstorm being lost. And here she is, being found not by humans, but by dogs, as she's almost frozen to death out here. Well, Mary Blair had left the studio in 53, so the design of a lady had other people working at it, and one of them was Ivan Durrell.
Ivan Durrell's best work, best known work, is his design work for Sleeping Beauty, a very, very stylized design for the entire film. But he was also a key contributor on Lady and the Tramp.
Ivan Durrell did the sequence of Bella Notte. He painted about 50 little tiny, maybe inch and a half by 2 inch long, little panels of studies of different ideas for that scene.
You can see his encrusted trees and the shadows and the very limited palette that he uses,
yeah.
Very simple shapes that read very well from across the room.
Well, he painted the great background where they're at the top of the hill in the park.
Uh-huh.
Walt said, I want you to paint the town in such a way that staying in town looks great. The town is wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And leaving the town on an adventure looks great.
Well, they put the whole movie at a low angle, so you're seeing it from the dog's point of view.
When you're down that low, it's a very horizontal world. The world is not defined by the sky. It's defined by the floor and the carpet and the lawn and the fire hydrant and all this stuff down there.
Claude Coates was trained in architecture, so I think he was particularly good at giving credibility to the environments.
Dad liked to build models so he could see dimensionally how things were going to translate to what he was doing in two dimension in the background.
Well, he told me that the only way that he could really get what it would be like from a dog's view was to move a camera into the model and look up at these tables and everything from a dog's view.
Like this one is from the viewpoint of Lady. Looking mm-hmm. up, so you see the bottom of everything.
If you look very closely at the models, you can see Jim, Deer, and Darling, and the dogs as cutouts.
Now you would build those models in a computer, and you'd fly the camera around. Well, they were doing exactly the same thing.
Lady and the Tramp started out as being full screen, but the popularity of CinemaScope had taken place, and Walt said, hey, we got to make this in CinemaScope. So he had us go back and elongate everything out on either side, and they would paste on this new stuff and then mask it with maybe an overlay of a tree where it was together, you know? So there was tricks going on constantly to do this.
To be able to use that full aperture in a meaningful way, you know, it was quite a trick.
Sometimes in the movie, you feel like they set up certain shots of the film in a very stationary kind of small way, and then they just simply added east and west onto the field, and it seems kind of lonely out there.
They had to put action out there. So when dogs were fighting with each other and they were in close, they spread them apart.
Where typically the camera might move more, in CinemaScope you can just let the camera sit and let the actors, in this case dogs, move around, move back and forth, deliver their dialogue, and just enjoy the scene a little bit more.
Homewreckers, that's what they are.
Look here, laddie, who are you to barge in?
The voice of experience, Buster.
One problem that Disney faced was that not all theaters were equipped to project CinemaScope.
It may have been Brother Roy who had the checkbook there in hand. He said, Walt, we're going to have to, it's going to, in a way, it's going to cost more money, but you're going to have to do two versions. Yeah.
So he had to produce a separate flat screen version, which again involved the layout men and replanning the action of the film.
So they actually animated two versions of it. One for the regular format picture, and one with the extra characters on the side for the widescreen.
You get the urge for a nice, comfortable scratch.
So I think that's why when they say, gee, we saw a different version of Lady and the Tramp. It didn't have that beautiful wide scene of all those houses. What happened to that? Well, it was the regular, smaller version.
We've got a look in Lady and the Tramp that's very unique, very believable, and very realistic, and still at the same time delivers that Disney magic.
Lady and the Tramp is certainly a film that's nostalgic for a bygone era in America's past. And maybe one of the reasons it feels that way is because Walt himself was nostalgic for that bygone era.
There were tough times here in Marceline for so many people on the farm.
Elias got sick and lost the farm, and they had an auction. And Roy and Walt had to pound in the telephone poles the announcement of the auction. And that was Paradise Lost.
There was this huge sense of community among the people who lived here.
He loved everything about Marceline, and he hated having to leave Marceline.
It was that sense of community, I think, that also followed Walt throughout his life.
Over the years, it became clear that the relatively short period of time that Walt spent in Marceline really stayed with him.
Walt saw that you didn't have to have a lot in your life, but you could give a lot in your life.
Today in Marceline, there's a reconstructed barn on the farm where Walt lived. If you go inside the barn, you can see written over all of the walls, thank you messages to Walt for all the great things that he brought us.
Dear Walt, seeing you on Sunday night meant so much to my family. Dear Walt, thank you for keeping Marceline so special. Dear Walt, you were a magic part of my childhood.
That's very important for younger generations because they can see somebody that influential the entire world over who grew up in small town America and was able to take something from there and make it into something that the world wanted.
Storyboard artist isn't necessarily Michelangelo, isn't necessarily a fabulous animator. What a great storyboard artist is a great communicator. Hi, this is a storyboard drawing, one of the essential tools in the making of an animated film. Storyboards allow the filmmakers to see a blueprint of the movie before we go into actual animation production. Walt Disney developed the use of storyboards way back in the 1920s for his classic Mickey Mouse cartoon, Steamboat Willie. Storyboards are like little comic book panels of the entire movie, and they're used by tacking them up on a bulletin board so you can actually see the continuity of the movie. You can see the rough staging and camera positions. You can see the acting of the characters. The dialogue is written underneath. In animation, storyboarding has always been and is still used mainly to develop the story.
Now, in our studio, we don't write our stories. We draw them.
Storyboards, being an effective and very inexpensive way of developing the content for the movie, gave Disney the opportunity to board up something and see if it worked before expensive animation took place.
You start off and you start visualizing it like a comic strip, kind of. You work out the business and you develop it that way. And then you look at it and you go, is this working? Is this funny? Is this dramatic? What can we change? So this is why we work like this, because these things can be changed so quickly, you know. They're on, they're off. And you can move things around and see how things play.
A great storyboard artist can put down on a storyboard the minimum amount of information necessary to get a very dynamic and quick read on the content and the emotions in the sequence.
When you're actually drawing the story sketches, you get emotional about them yourself, and so you're looking for things that have a lot of heart and you are trying to draw that in a very simple way to express what you're feeling, that's great story sketching.
Hitchcock said storyboard artist has to be a good storyteller. It isn't enough to just make a beautiful drawing. The drawing has to have the meaning and the feelings of what you were trying to say.
Usually if you have a good storyboard artist, he's also a good pitch artist as well.
When you're pitching a board, you do all the parts and everything. You take on the characters, you change your voice, and you'd even add effects, you know. You'd take on a woman's voice, the old man's voice, or whatever it was. And it was very harrowing when you'd bring Walt into the room because he could pitch better than anybody. Once he got rolling, he would get excited, he would act it out, and you sat there mesmerized by Walt's storytelling. That was Walt's great ability.
A storyboard pitch is one of the great performance arts that was developed in this century at Disney's, and no one ever gets to see it.
The next step after you've shown your board, it's been okayed, everybody loves it, let's put it on a story reel.
Those storyboards are taken and shot on film and timed to a rough soundtrack. So you can actually see the movie playing in real time before any animation takes place.
Walt Disney invented the idea of making these story reels, telling the story in a simple form before you enter the more complex form. It was, at the time, I think, incredibly innovative, as most of what Walt Disney had done.
Often storyboard artists are noted for putting in business, putting in interesting things for the characters to do.
Every artist usually winds up having something that they really excel at, you know, whether it be the emotional end of it or whether they are for the chases. Willie Reitherman, he was the expert on chases.
You definitely cast storyboard artists according to what their strengths are. Some storyboard artists are really comic artists, and they will concentrate on the humor. Other artists are much more cinematic, and you would use them for action scenes.
Walt was very smart. He cast the story people who he thought were going to be the best ones on that particular sequence.
Soon, a lot of Hollywood was noticing how good Walt Disney's movies were, and the use of storyboards was a large part of that. Over the years, this process was adopted by Disney's live-action directors. And now, storyboards are used on almost every live-action production around the world.
There are so many people involved in the motion picture-making process that everybody has to be aware of the central needs of the film. And that's where the storyboard can let everybody in on the secrets.
If I can make things work on paper, then I can make them work on the set. And if I can create a visual style on paper, I can absolutely create it on God's green earth.
I worked with Jeffrey Katzenberg on the Shrek movies, who had really read everything that Walt Disney had ever written about filmmaking. So I was very lucky to learn Walt Disney's technique of using the storyboards as a writing storytelling tool. In The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, I storyboarded the whole film so I could actually watch the movie before I started shooting it. In order to convince people to give me the time to storyboard the whole movie ahead of time, I said, look, this is an expensive writing tool, but a really inexpensive production tool.
The storyboard indicates what you will see on the screen and also indicate what you don't need to spend money on. The storyboard can cut out a lot of unnecessary work.
My attachment to storyboards is I act and direct.
Boom.
And I like to kind of be able to take the pressure off myself by anticipating how I'm going to shoot something, and then I can sense new opportunities on the set that could not have been necessarily anticipated in a room where I was drawing with an artist.
When a storyboard artist works with a director on a film, it's kind of like he's been given a portion of the pie. What the storyboard artist gets to do is add a lot of his own touches to the material.
Storyboards are a great way to keep everyone on the page. And creatively, it's a great way to start creating and visualizing the movie itself.
All right, well, let's turn this thing around.
I had a lot of fun with Mick Reinman coming up with ways to visualize this story. And we would sit around in my barn and We would come up with different things. Hey, what about this ladybug? We'll have the power hitter, Ted Ray's getting ready to just hit this massive drive. And what if a ladybug drops down the ball and it becomes like a drama about the ladybug? And so we had a lot of fun laying all that out.
My first day on the film Saboteur, it was my first real contact with Hitchcock. I was on one side of the desk, he was on the other, and he would make his little drawings, and then I would make some on the same sequence. I think Hitchcock was really testing me.
What I try to do is start off with the scenes where I really maybe want to establish my film language. Maybe on the first scene, take them through step by step. Like I want a big horizon shot, and then I want, you know, a wagon coming from right to left. But then I'll let them do all the scenes after that by themselves, because I would rather have the benefit in this collaborative atmosphere to have him think of an idea that I never would have thought of.
Well, I started with a script, and in the script I would make very rough drawings. Then I would go to Hitchcock, and we would discuss the various sequences and see if my thoughts were anything near like his.
In live action, the use of storyboarding really kind of evolved into a tool for staging, so they know where they have to set the cameras, what the special effects might be.
If there were difficult passages, take a film like The Birds, in which we had to get these little flying creatures into almost every shot, we needed a storyboard of practically the whole film. And also in a very complex film like Saboteur. Saboteur needed a lot of drawing so that everybody knew what our problems were.
Quite often when we're about to shoot a scene, we'll actually start by pinning up all the storyboards. It's often a useful tool to communicate to your art directors, the set designers, you know, sometimes the actors, kind of this is what the scene is doing, and really block out the scene using the storyboards as a point of reference.
The notion that a picture's worth a thousand words, it really comes into play when you're dealing with storyboards, because I can really get eight people behind me and I can point and everybody can suddenly be on the same page.
With a lot of big sequences in live action, with battles and so on, you'll have three or four units shooting at once. So those storyboards become a tool to communicate to them. You give them to your second unit director, say, I need this shot, this shot, this shot.
Open Range, for instance, there's the final shootout sequence, which is about 12 days on a schedule. And 9 out of those 12 days, I had to go to cover sets because we were experiencing weather changes. We needed the light that we started the sequence in to be the light that we ended it in. So the storyboard saved me. When we actually were going to come back to that sequence, which was very elaborate, everybody knew what we were going to be coming back to. There was going to be no guesswork. And so I find them my greatest tool, actually, the storyboard.
Live-action directors use storyboards for a variety of purposes in the filmmaking process. But in animation, storyboards have always been and are still used to develop the story and the characters. Walt Disney was a great story developer and a great story editor. If he saw a sequence on boards that he didn't think was working, it would come out of the movie and a new one would be developed.
So you throw the whole thing out and you start from scratch and you'd get all excited again and start building it up. I think a great storyboard artist has that ability to get excited after it's been shot down and move on and build the excitement over again.
The amount of time spent on developing a Disney film was often decades. There are early versions in the 1930s of storyboards for Alice in Wonderland, storyboards for Peter Pan, even though those movies didn't come out until the 1950s. For Lady and the Tramp, Joe Grant actually pitched the idea to Walt in 1937, and active storyboard development didn't take place until 43. The movie itself came out in 55. So you can see almost a 20-year period there of developing what actually got into Lady and the Tramp.
If we boarded a version and it wasn't quite working, Walt would say, well, let's not follow this version, let's start another version. every drawing you're not throwing out. It didn't matter because out of the whole thing, what they were suggesting was it going to be better. We would have the storyboard shot with the still camera, and we would make an 8x10 negative. So every storyboard was recorded, and then the individual sketches would be taken off the storyboard, and then they'd be filed away.
Walt Disney, in the purest sense, was an artist, but he also had that idiosyncrasy of an artist who just throws his great work away because in some way it doesn't match up. But listen, every cartoon is still measured against Walt Disney. He knew the difference. And I would trust him. I would trust him. And we do trust him. We trust him with our children.
In preparation for this DVD, we went to the studio archives and we saw a lot of references to photostats of a complete set of storyboards for the film that were done in June 1943.
And digging deeper, we found a written treatment of the same date.
With these clues in hand, we excavated a little further at the studio photo library, and there we found 8x10 negatives of the entire set of storyboards from June 1943.
So armed with the written treatment and the visual reference, we went to the Animation Research Library. In an attempt to find the original artwork, we proceeded to go through thousands of individual Lady and the Tramp storyboard drawings.
Luckily, we were able to find almost 80% of the original storyboard panels. So now we were in a position to reconstruct the 1943 storyboard version. 60 years later, we can actually now look at the origins of what was to eventually become the movie Lady and the Tramp. Just imagine, it's 1943 and you're sitting in on a pitch for the latest movie in development at the Walt Disney Studios, Lady. How's it start, Bernie?
We open up with movies being shown by Mr. and Mrs. Fred.
Remember the first day we got her? Gee, she was cute. And with my new slippers. Well, they were too tight anyway.
Yeah. She was right at home, in my new hat.
Oh, her first flea. So I decided to give her a bath. But it didn't do any good.
Her first birthday party. Gosh, that was fun.
Wasn't she cute? Her fur looked like a skirt.
That's when we named her Lady. Okay, how do you like being a movie star, Lady? At the end of the home movie reel, Lady is asleep.
I guess she doesn't like your movie, dear.
She wakes up startled and jumps at the screen while everybody, including the baby, laughs.
Goodness, it's late.
Lady kisses the baby and is put to bed fondly in her little basket.
Come along, Lady. Good night.
Cross dissolve to a rainy day. Homer, a tramp dog and friend of Lady's from earlier days in the dog pound, is hitchhiking to call on Lady. He is splashed by mud from passing cars. When he arrives at Lady's house, he howls for her. Lady is asleep, but hears him, looks out the window, and rushes pell-mell down the stairs. She meets Homer on the porch, and they discuss Lady's new home, which she likes very much.
Oh, don't go away.
Lady shows Homer her album with pictures of herself.
This is me with the baby.
Doesn't look like much fun.
And this is my friend Trilby, the canary.
Oi!
Well, I really didn't care for it myself, but you've got to humor them, you know.
She asks Homer whether or not he has changed his mind about family life. But Homer has decided to remain a bum. Cross dissolve to the next morning. Lady is asleep on the couch. The canary, Trilby, is singing. Lady wakes up, hears hoofbeats on the pavement outside, and goes out to meet the milkman.
Good dog, Lady.
The paper boy comes along. He throws the paper. Lady catches it, brings it into the house, and puts it on the table. Then she goes upstairs to wake everyone up. She jumps from bed to bed and tries to reach the alarm clock. It rings,
and startles her. But Mr. and Mrs. Fred get up, pet her, and she feels happy and rewarded for a job well done.
So the baby's still asleep, but Lady comes over and wakes her up.
With a little slurp. Cross dissolve to, during breakfast, a car arrives.
Mother! Get Mother's bags out of the car, dear.
I hope that baby doesn't look like that simple husband of yours. You idiot! Be careful with those bags.
She rushes on to one of the suitcases and opens it, disclosing Nip and Tuck, twin Siamese cats who are show-offs.
Did the nasty mans hurt Mumsy Wumsy's itsy-bitsy babies?
They take immediate dislike to Lady and scare her.
What's that mangy mutt doing here?
Hey, that's our dog. Come here, Lady, and meet Mother.
Humph!
Cross dissolve to Lady takes Nip and Tuck for a tour of a house.
I'm glad you've come to visit us. Let me show you around the place. This is the kitchen, and over there's the icebox. Here's the back porch. You can have a lot of fun under it. I've been lonely and wanted someone to play with. It'll be nice to have someone to play with. The cellar is down there. I suppose you girls like to hunt mice?
Mice?
And that's the baby's room. Don't make any noise. She's asleep.
At that point, they run off from Lady and drink baby's milk. Lady gets angry and fights them.
So, stealing the baby's milk. As punishment, she should live outside. Besides, it's more sanitary. That dog is dangerous. She must be muzzled.
So Homer's strolling at night, and he hears sobs. He looks off stage, and he sees a lady in her house. And he goes over to her, and he says, "What's the matter?"
And Lady tries to explain, and Homer says, "Well, why don't you come with me?" But Lady looks back up at the baby's window, and she says, "I can't. I might be needed here." And we cross-dissolve, too.
The next morning, Nip and Tuck see the milkman arrive. They tip over the milk bottles he delivers, drink the milk, and roll the bottles down in front of Lady's house, where she is sleeping. She is discovered with the bottles, accused of drinking the milk. Cross-dissolve to the kitchen.
The coast is clear.
And cold chicken in the icebox.
She thinks she can fool us.
But we'll put the bones in her house.
And she'll get the blame.
So, robbing the icebox, you mangy mutt.
The icebox door is slammed with the cats inside. Lady tries to tell her, but is chased out.
Thief! Get out and stay out! My babies, my babies, where are my babies?
Oh, don't worry, Mother. We found them in time.
The cats are thawed out in a hot tub.
Cross dissolve, too.
The canary is singing, and the cats wake up, and they slowly start creeping toward the bird while Lady is asleep. There is a hubbub as the cats try to get the canary. Lady wakes up. One of the cats bangs on the piano to cover the noise of the canary screaming to Lady to help. There's a tussle. The cats break the canary cage. Someone comes, and again, Lady is found in trouble with the cage broken and the canary out. She is accused of doing it while the cats hide behind the curtains. Lady tries to show where they are, but they climb up on the top of the windows and cannot be seen. Cross dissolve to the pet shop. Lady is fitted with a muzzle. Many different kinds are tried on her.
Oh, you might prefer this one.
No.
This one?
No.
Oh, maybe this.
Definitely not. Oh, no. Horrible. Oh, disgusting. Oh, what are you thinking, young man? No. 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 Oh, no.
Cross dissolve to Lady kicking in her sleep. Something's wrong. She wakes up and she sees the shadow of a rat going across the cellar. She tries to growl and bristle, and she tries to break free, but that leash is holding her back. We then see the shadow of the rat go up into the house through the kitchen. Lightning flashes, and the shadow goes upstairs into the baby's nursery where the baby is sleeping.
Then the cat wakes up
as the shadow passes over them and they leap into their basket and close the lid behind them.
And then finally, Lady breaks free from the leash.
She runs upstairs through the door and into the baby's room and jumps over the bassinet in the direction of the rat, knocking the crib over. The rat disappears behind the blocks, but when Lady dives into the blocks, the rat has jumped onto the shelf. There is a lot of commotion while Lady captures the rat. Family arrives, awakened by all the noise.
Oh, I warned you about that terrible dog. Now look, that dog is a baby killer. You must get rid of her at once.
I never thought you'd do a thing like this, Lady. Lady is kicked out into the street, in the wind, in the rain, and is very dejected. Look, a dead rat. Lady was protecting the baby. Why, if it hadn't been for Lady, I'm going out to find her. And where were your precious cats?
All right, we know when we're not wanted.
Meanwhile, Lady sits shivering out in the snow. It is Christmas time, and she goes around the street following shoppers and looking in store windows, but no one pays any attention to her. She's even hit by an umbrella. The wind blows a man's hat into the street. Lady tries to rescue him, hoping he will be grateful and take her home with him. Mr. Fred arrives on the scene. Please, let me through. Oh, poor lady. Will you ever forgive us? Dissolved to a Christmas scene. Lady is home with the baby, surrounded by her five puppies.
Everyone's happy. There's lots of gifts for Lady under the tree. And in the final scene, Mrs. Fred tries to get Homer involved in the act. Come on, Homer. You're in this too. And Homer's a little embarrassed, but he's really proud of his and Lady's puppies tumbling around and playing about them.
Fade out, the end.
Walt Disney began hosting his own weekly television series in 1954. The show was called Disneyland, even though construction had only just begun for the theme park. Walt often used this show to give his TV audiences a unique behind-the-scenes look at the development of the Disneyland park and the process of creating his movies. These shows served as a great promotional tool for creating awareness for Disney's latest theatrical releases. Although we're used to seeing such things today, this insider's view was quite unusual for its time. Walt was a visionary in another way, too. Even though the TV shows were being broadcast in black and white, he had many of them photographed in color and stored in the vault for possible future use. In 1961, the TV series switched networks, changed its name, and was now being broadcast in color. This gave Walt the opportunity to rerun some of the older episodes using the color masters for the first time. The episode in the Disneyland series entitled Cavalcade of Songs was one of those shows that served a dual purpose. It promoted the upcoming release of Lady and the Tramp by giving viewers a behind-the-scenes look at the process of writing the songs for the movie. With the film scheduled for a June 1955 premiere, this show originally aired on February 16, 1955, in black and white. In 1962, Lady and the Tramp was re-released to theaters. Walt used this opportunity to run Cavalcade of Songs again, 7 years after its original broadcast. However, for this showing, the color masters were used for the first time. Another earlier show that promoted Lady and the Tramp was entitled A Story of Dogs. It originally aired on December 1st, 1954, and was never shown again on the original Disneyland series. Since it was only the sixth episode filmed, it was thought to exist only in black and white. In creating this special edition DVD, our researchers discovered rare color elements for A Story of Dogs. The entire show was never assembled in color. No complete print exists. What we're going to see is a segment of this show that was pieced together using many different source elements. The key to this recreation was the surprise discovery of the original editor's work print from 1954. Now, work prints are usually temporary black and white copies, but this one was in color. However, the color had faded to this. Modern digital technology allowed us to transform it into this. So as you watch this excerpt from A Story of Dogs, you'll notice some changes in the picture quality. Some sections are from pristine camera negatives that had been tucked away for over 50 years in film cans simply labeled trims or outtakes. Other portions came from the work print, which was worn out and still had traces of the editor's marks on the film. Despite its occasional flaws, we believe this is a rare opportunity to see this color footage for the first time. By the way, most of Cavalcade of Songs has also been reassembled for this DVD using recently uncovered pristine film elements. Neither show devoted the full hour time slot to Lady and the Tramp, but the two shows are unique in the amount of broadcast time Walt Disney devoted to revealing how one of his animated features was created. We hope you enjoy these newly assembled segments from two of the classic Disney TV shows.
What a dog.
Walt Disney's Disneyland. And this week from Fantasyland, presenting A Story of Dogs. Tonight or very soon, see one of the many fine motion pictures playing at your favorite theater. Shortly after the first of the year, see Walt Disney's first full-length cartoon feature in CinemaScope, Lady and the Tramp. The first Walt Disney feature-length cartoon in CinemaScope, Lady and the Tramp.
Now, before we go, we'd like to bring you a few scenes from our Fantasyland show next week. It's about dogs. One of them's an old friend. The other two you haven't met as yet. Now, here they are, a heroine, Lady, and her boyfriend, the Tramp.
From Fantasyland, behind the scenes as the Disney artists create the first all-cartoon CinemaScope feature, Lady and the Tramp. You'll go from the story room to the director's desk where scenes are planned. And voice is given to the cartoon characters.
But darling has never struck me before. But darling has never struck me before.
You'll watch the animator at work creating these actual scenes from Lady and the Tramp.
What's a baby?
Just a cute little bundle of trouble. Yeah. They scratch, pinch, pull ears. Oh, but shucks, any dog can take that. It's what they do to your happy home. Move it over, will you, friend? Homewreckers, that's what they are.
Look here, laddie. Who are you to barge in?
The voice of experience, Buster. Boy, just wait till Junior gets here.
Follow Lady and the Tramp through the inking, painting, and background departments. Meet another quaint character who plays an important part in Lady's life.
I wonder if you'd do us a little...
Busy, Sonny. Busy.
This'll only take a second of your time.
Gotta get this log moving, Sonny. Gotta get it moving. Taint the cutting takes a time. It's your doggone hauling.
Now, what you need
is... better bisect this section here.
What you need is a log puller.
I said a log puller! I ain't deep, Sonny.
And from the album of Pluto... highlights from the career of Walt Disney's first canine star. See Pluto in his Academy Award-winning picture, Lend a Paw.
Save him, Pluto. Save the paw, little kitty. Be kind. Be merciful.
Ah, let him drown. He got you kicked out, didn't he?
You must save him.
Nah, don't be a sap.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
All this you'll see. The story of Pluto, plus behind the scenes of the first CinemaScope cartoon feature, Lady and the Tramp. Next week, with Walt Disney in Fantasyland. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a preview of the motion picture event soon to be seen in this theater. We would like to show you and tell you something about Walt Disney's Lady and the Tramp. It's his happiest motion picture, a story about dogs. Open your heart and build some glowing memories as Walt Disney takes you into that wonderful world you always hoped did exist and never knew for sure until now, the world of dogs. To anyone who's ever owned a dog, loved a dog, or just wanted a dog, this picture is yours, heart and soul. You'll meet Lady, the belle of the social set. She was beautiful, innocent, intelligent. And besides, she owned the nicest family in town. Lady was the catch of the season. That is, until the day the Tramp came into her life. Tramp, soldier of fortune, the Casanova from the wrong side of the tracks who wore no man's collar.
It's what they do to your happy home. Move it over, will you, friend?
You'll meet Jock, officially known as Heather Ladd of Glencairn, of the Blue Blood Glencairns, who collected blue ribbons, silver cups, and bones.
That's a grand sight.
There's Faithful Trusty, the bloodhound of the Old South, but now given to dreams of faded glories. And there are the rollicking, roistering boys in the back room down at the dog pound. Boris, remnant of the old aristocracy who has fallen on evil days.
He's like Gorky says in Lower Depths, quote, miserable being must find more miserable being. Then he's happy.
Pedro, whose visa and luck ran out at the same time.
And my sister... Rosita, Chiquita, Juanita, Chihuahua.
And Peg, slightly shop-worn soubrette from the Dog and Pony Follies, who knew many things, One of them, how to sell a song.
If he's a tramp, he's a good one. And I wish that I could travel his way. Wish that I could travel his way. Wish that I could travel his way.
And you'll meet Mr. Busy, the eager beaver.
6'6" and 7/16".
And the pair of mischievous Orientals, Cy and Am.
We are Siamese, if you please. We are Siamese, if you don't please.
It's Easter, it's Christmas, it's New Year's Eve. All the merry celebrations of your life rolled into one happy entertainment as Lady and the Tramp take you into their enchanted world.
What a dog.
He's a tramp.
For everyone, everywhere comes fine family motion picture entertainment from Walt Disney, Lady and the Tramp, starring some of the doggondest Disney characters. See Walt Disney's happiest motion picture, Lady and the Tramp. Always look to Walt Disney for the best motion pictures for your family. Motion pictures like Lady and the Tramp.
This Christmas season, Walt Disney Pictures unwraps a very special holiday treat. Lady and the Tramp. She's a lucky little lady who's been catered to, pampered, and indulged. He's a wild and carefree rascal, totally independent, always into mischief. She's a little angel. He's full of the devil. But put them together, and it could only lead to one thing. It's love unleashed.
He's a tramp, but they love him.
This is living!
Breaks a new heart every day.
I gotta get you out.
He's a tramp, but I love him. And I wish that I could travel his way.
It's coming your way this Christmas.
Look who's here. Butcher, he's got a new girlfriend.
You're cordially invited to share the magic, the romance, and the adventure of one of animation's most unforgettable tales.
Open up your eyes to what a dog's life can really be.
Open your heart to Walt Disney's classic, Lady and the Tramp.
Thank you.